Yeah, my name is Nathan Klingbeil. I'm a professor of mechanical engineering. I'm also the associate dean for academic affairs in the College of Engineering and Computer Science. As a nation, we face a problem of not graduating enough engineers to kind of keep up with the demand of the global economy. And in the Dayton region, it's the same thing. We have a large demand for people with technical training in engineering and other STEM disciplines. There's a big market for these people, both at the Air Force base, but in the local industry that supports that mission. And our primary job is to, as a state university, how can we take students that are average American high school students and turn them into outstanding engineers and computer scientists? The biggest challenge, I think, in engineering education, not just at Wright State, but across the country, is really the curriculum that the students face when they arrive. It's important, you know, to try and recruit the best students we can to come into the program, but even with our best students, they don't have a sense for exactly all the math and science that they had in high school. How does that relate to what they do at the university level, and how is that going to make them successful? Students come in really underprepared for what they're going to face in terms of required calculus sequence, in terms of the required physics and chemistry and basic sciences. And so even students coming to the university from high school, if you ask them, well, why do you want to be an engineer? Why do you want to be a computer scientist? They say things like, well, you know, I'm good at math. I'm good at science. My teacher told me to go be an engineer, I can get a good job. Hey, and the problem is they can't relate the math and science that's presented in high school to what they really need in engineering. They don't really have an understanding of exactly what we do as engineers. We come in with the population of students, which is an average cross-section of American high school graduates, not ready to start calculus, and once they do, it's completely disconnected from the curriculum. And so we decided as an engineering faculty, that we weren't going to use calculus as a litmus test for our programs. And so what we proposed in 2003 is what we call our national model for engineering mathematics education. And we came up with a plan to introduce a first-year engineering math class. It's EGR 101, Introductory Math for Engineering Applications. The course was developed by myself and colleagues from all the departments in the program, and also with some assistance from the Department of Math and Statistics. And we pitched the idea to the National Science Foundation and said, look, we want to have a front-end class that tells the students, this is how you're going to use math in your chosen degree program. And we're not just going to talk about, you know, preparatory math before calculus. We're going to talk about all the math that's actually used in first and second year engineering courses. The course is now the cornerstone of the required curriculum for six of our degree programs. And we're now at the point where we put some 300 students a year through EGR 101. And that initial change that we made to the curriculum had a dramatic impact on student retention and success. We saw first year retention rates jump by about 10% the very first year that we introduced the course. In fact, now the course first ran in fall 2004. We've seen impact all the way through graduation rates. In fact, 70% of students that took EGR 101 earned a Wright State degree. And then the success that we had in terms of students being retained in the program, better performance in calculus, higher graduation rates has really led to the expansion across the country. So we have four institutions in Texas, we have three institutions in California, three of the five institutions that offer engineering in Oklahoma are on our team. We have an institution in Washington State, in Michigan, and in Virginia in the DC area as well. As part of that initiative, we've also expanded our approaches to K-12 education. In fact, locally, we're offering EGR 101 in area high schools. It's been running at Bellbrook High School since 2008. We are also involved with bringing the materials to the Dayton Regional STEM School as part of offering dual credit opportunities for college. The approach has actually been used as the core of a pre-college engineering program at a science academy in the D.C. area and has now been approved actually as K-12 engineering curricula by the state of Virginia. We take student success extremely seriously. In fact, as Associate Dean for Academic Affairs, recruitment and retention of students is one of my primary responsibilities. And so in my mind, I would view reforming the required curriculum in a way that is accessible, but also guarantees high caliber education to even the best students. I think that's step number one. And I think that we are well on our way to having taken care of that. And in fact, in terms of students being successful and understanding how math and science relates to what they need in engineering, I think Wright State is really the premier institution in the country in that regard. Okay. But I do think there's a lot more that can be done. Okay. And in fact, once students are engaged and they're successful and they can get past the math sequence, okay, we also want students to be engaged through the sophomore and junior years. We want students to graduate in 4 years, not in 5 years, not in 6 years. And so there's a variety of other student success initiatives that are now underway in the college. For example, we recently instituted a peer mentoring program, and it's a peer mentoring program that really speaks to the dedication of our continuing students, where we basically solicited from our entire class of students an opportunity to serve as a peer mentor, okay, and to provide contact information and attend a welcome social and basically be a resource for first-year students. And we got an overwhelming response. In fact, 60 upper division students in our college volunteered to serve as peer mentors for an incoming class of 300 to 350 first-year students. So we have, you know, only 5 or 6 first-year students per peer mentor that now have an upper division student that they can kind of go to or ask questions about or receive guidance about how to be successful in engineering. We've also instituted a help room to help upper division students with their courses. Again, it's done on a volunteer basis. In fact, students can register for credit in what we call peer tutoring in engineering. And what they do is they receive a certain amount of credit for their service in the help room. And they help students with upper division 300 and 400 level courses, as well as first year students with math and basic science courses. You know, what we're trying to do here with curricular reform in the College of Engineering and Computer Science is really critical to the local economy, okay? Because what we really have a demand for is more highly qualified engineers and computer scientists to work in the technology-based economy. In fact, I sit on the board of the Dayton Regional STEM School, and there's a number of other board members on that school that are donating their time to try and develop this pipeline, because in their own companies, in their own disciplines, they don't have enough personnel to fill the jobs that they need. And so it's critically important. And to the extent that you can address that with curriculum reform, I think we've made a fairly substantial impact. In fact, if you look at the numbers of engineers and computer scientists graduated in the last 2 years, 2010, 2011, we graduated some 25 more engineers and computer scientists than we had 5 or 6 years before on average. And so we're seeing the impact of the curriculum reforms all the way to graduation.